University of New South Wales and the director of the Australian Centre for Astrobiology. And we investigate the origins and the evolution of the earliest life on Earth and think about how that might apply to the search for life on other planets, particularly the search for life on Mars. So from the geological point of view, we are here in what's known as the Pilbara Craton, a very ancient piece of crust that preserves the rocks with such exceptional clarity that we can still identify original features of the Earth 3.5 billion years ago. And that makes it almost unique in the entire world. These are the oldest, best preserved rocks on the planet that contain signs of life. And we're here to look at that sign of life and understand how it adapted to a very early Earth condition. This is a very long-lived piece of crust that formed over 800 million years of Earth history, from almost 3.5 billion years ago to much younger time. And it evolved through multiple pulses of magmatism coming out of the mantle, and then that being intruded and melted, and there's all kinds of history here. And my job has been to unpick that history and understand how this piece of crust came to be, and also what habitats were available as that very early crust was being formed. And that's what I'm really passionate about. I'm passionate about understanding what the early Earth was like. What was the color of the sky? What was the composition and color of the oceans? What was life living on 3.5 billion years ago? So the question is, which areas in Europe and North America can this be compared with? Well, the answer is very simple. Nothing. This is unique to Australia and one part of South Africa that has similar crust. But this age of rocks and this style of the crust formation and deformation is not found anywhere in Europe. It's all too young. And in North America, they have similar rocks, but also younger. So this is a globally unique treasure trove of the snapshot of early Earth. So the question is, are there comparable structures from the Pilbara Craton to a comet that's currently flying through space in our solar system? So of course, the very earliest Earth, 1 billion years before the Pilbara crust was formed, you know, as the solar system was nucleating comets and asteroids, they were all accreting to make what we now call planet Earth. But that's a very early process, and the comets are remnants of that very earliest process. They're some of the earliest solar system materials. Now, this planet and this crust is way past that. Many cycles of heating and aggregation and melting and recycling, and it's all changed since then. So this is way down the track of differentiating the planet through time. So if you think about life in the Pilbara, this is really an exceptional area, right where we're standing. And the drilling that you see going on behind me is actually sampling crust under the surface and the effects of oxidative weathering. And we are searching for signs of life. So these rocks just behind me here contain the oldest, most convincing evidence of life on planet Earth, in rocks that are 3.48 billion years old. And on the surface, the signs of that life are these little wriggly and sometimes domal shapes that we see in the rocks that we can't describe to normal geological processes. So geology is dominated by physics, water moving particles around, but we can see these other structures that are interfering with that geological process, and we think those are signs of life. And what we're trying to do is prove that by looking for remnants of organic matter trapped in the minerals below the surface. And we found some. The exciting thing is, from a previous drilling program, we found remnants of organic matter trapped in those wrinkly laminated structures that we think are stromatolites, microbial communities. And what we're doing now is to try and test better with bigger samples and collect it by using a clean drilling process where it's only using water to see if we can extract that organic matter and find out what kind of microbes were living at that time. If we were able to look inside this part of the Pilbara, what would we see? Well, we can see on the surface these units of rocks that are dipping down to below the surface. And what we're doing with the drilling is proving that they continue down for 100 meters or so. We can understand that these rocks, we can continue them down to about 14 kilometers in the crust. But below that, it's out of the reach of our actual visual observations using drills or whatever. And the composition of the crust changes. And as you go down, it continues to change until about 35 kilometers depth. And then you get into the Earth's mantle. So at about 35 kilometers, that's what's known as the Moho-Mohorovnich discontinuity. And below that, the composition changes. But like I said before, with the Pilbara, it's unique. You go down and down and down and down and down into the mantle until about 250 kilometers down. And instead of being liquid mantle like around the rest of the world, it's frozen mantle. And it's frozen mantle from which a melt has been extracted, leaving a residual component. And that is a process that allows diamonds to form. And in that deep keel, there are diamonds that sometimes get brought to the surface here and in South Africa and make many of the famous mines known for mining diamonds. So that whole process of making the crust in the Pilbara also makes these unique minerals that are of benefit to mankind. So the question is, how do these rocks look at depth? What are the colors and the textures as you go down? Well, the crust of the Earth is an interface between cold temperatures and, in fact, space temperatures, minus 273 degrees, surface 25 degrees, and the mantle at 1300 degrees. And so the crust is this incredible conductive unit, and as you go down, it gets warmer and warmer and warmer. So even in the deepest mines on Earth, as you go down, it gets 45, 50 degrees, and as you keep going down, it gets hotter and hotter. And about the middle of the crust actually starts to melt. It gets soft and swirly. And these rocks, with all their angular, jagged lines and stuff, they become soft and they start to flow like plasticine. And so you get these beautiful, big fold structures, kilometer scale fold structures, soaked by melted rocks that are light in color. So the texture of these sort of green and dark hills with angular lines changes completely as you go down to the soft, goopy mess that becomes much lighter in color. So yeah, we can really imagine that sort of changing structure, changing temperature, changing texture as we go down into the mantle.